Hi, welcome to show 67, and we are joined this week by the legendary Cookie Crew.
That's right, or the warm milk and...
Let's get it right.
We've got a phenomenal interview coming up in a little bit.
Totally,
it goes
yeah.
on for about 14 days. Calling sick from work, you're going to want to watch this.
You ain't going to want to miss it, no sir. No,
and if
sir.
You're a certain rapper from the 80s in the States, you're in trouble.
That's right, yeah. From Philadelphia. No! No names.
Anyway, our first track?
Yeah, our first track. What is our first track?
Pick up on this.
That's right.
Alright.
So this would have been on the first album.
First album, Born This Way, produced by Daddy O.
Of course. Yeah. They don't like to name drop, but you know, you have to really,
oh,
don't you?
And DBC, you can't forget DBC.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, nah, killer track this, absolutely brilliant. And this is actually on the 12, which has got the B-boy mix of Got To Keep On as well, which we'll be going to next. So, well, nice to have you in the shed anyway, ladies. And here we go, another history lesson. Let's go. Yeah, this is the B-boy remix of Got To Keep On, which was a huge smash for you guys, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Which was originally, it sounded very electro-like, the original version, yeah. But I'd say I did like this one,
yeah,
because of the big funky James Brown drum break, which is on this album right here. There you go.
Excellent.
There you go.
And but, we had to have this mix so that we could feel happy.
Yeah, especially performing live. We love all our tracks, it's always good to have that kind of hardcore version, especially if we had dance on stage.
And did you, when you perform live, was it this version or was it the other version?
So yeah, we've done this version.
Oh, right, okay.
It's all about this version. Yeah.
Cool. Cool. Glad we played it. I have to say thank you for Trevor, who loaned me his copy because my one is buried there and I couldn't find it last night, so I had to run over his house and get it. So say hello, Trevor.
Hi, Trevor.
There you go.
He's a big fan.
He is a big fan. He's having kittens about this. Look at this. If the shed was a bit bigger, me and Brad would be the dancers.
You should see our feet.
Oh yeah, that's right. It's like Michael Flatley below here, you know what I mean? Lord of the Dance. Wicked track, absolutely love this track. And we're going to go to another one as well.
Before we go, I think, because we were talking about Edwin Starr.
Oh yeah, that's right. Yeah. So yeah, obviously Edwin Starr on this, and he ended up being a bit of a friend of yours as well.
He did, yeah, absolutely amazing,
great supporter,
amazing guy,
yeah.
And he supported us in everything, gave us advice in so many things, and he's just a lovely, lovely guy, and we just were privileged to work with him. It was amazing,
a legend,
yeah.
Rest in peace, Edwin Starr.
Yeah.
Right. So here we go, to Born This Way. Oh, I absolutely love this. Now, and when it first came out, I was a big, big fan. Fucking tune. Anyway. Yeah, Shaft in Africa, all over this one. This is another one that's Stetsasonic producer.
Oh, absolutely. Daniel had it down packed. He just knew what to do with us.
Yeah.
And it works. We completely collaborated, in such a smooth transaction.
Everything he played us, every break he played us, we liked. Everything he put on, said, how about this? We're like, we love it. Easy to write to as well. Once we started writing this, we were just like, it's easy.
Yeah. Totally cool. Brilliant video as well. And you had a couple of famous people in there as well. So there was like Fab Five Freddy in there.
Yeah. Search,
MC Search. Yeah, that's right, yeah.
They're out on the road again now.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow, they kissed and made up. God bless you, fellas. There you go. Anyway, wicked. Well, after this, we're going to go to this wicked interview. So here we go. Right, okay. So, welcome to the shed, Susie Q and MC Remedee, aka the Cookie Crew.
Yeah.
First time being interviewed in around about 15 years, so we've got a bit of a treat on our hands today, I reckon. Good afternoon.
Afternoon, guys. Hello. And the world, I should say.
Yeah, of course, yeah, because we do reach out.
The world tunes into the shed.
Yeah, a few hundred of them anyway.
Well, this is a world exclusive.
That's right. As we always do, we tend to ask how you first got into music, primarily. So, how did that begin for you guys? And who wants to go first?
Well, I've got to put it down to starting off with our parents. Mm-hmm. My dad has and still has a massive
massive record collection. And growing up, he was always playing records, a lot of Motown, a lot of obscure people that we hadn't heard of. And that's how we got into listening to music all the time, looking at the back of records, reading everything that was, you know, how all about it. So that's how we got involved. And one of the groups that we were used to be mad in were Earth, Wind and Fire. And we used to go to our youth club. I don't know what they made of us in the church.
They let us get on.
We
with
used
it.
To get on the stage and sing Fantasy.
We knew that down to a T.
Like, what's wrong with these girls? We used to just, and everyone would be playing pool and Tate would be up there, guys singing, whatever.
I'd love to have YouTube footage of that.
Obviously that's how long we've known each other. We grew up together. We live one road away from each other.
So our whole environment. Yeah. We were raised with music, you know, through Susan's household, my household. Yeah. And also going to church, and we also say church. We're not wasn't like a gospel sing up thing. Church was like our foundation, because it was like Friday evenings we used to go to youth clubs. So that's where we used to kind of, that was our opportunity to express ourselves by taking hold of a stage that was there, learning other people's songs and dancing and doing stuff. And you know, we just kind of got on with it and listening to radio. We always had like pirate radio.
Yeah.
On like Saturdays, and like Greg Edwards, we used to listen to on Saturday. Greg Edwards live at the Lyceum. We used to listen to Gary Kent. I think that was on Solar Radio. So there's certain stations that we've always tuned into.
And what sort of stuff were you listening to?
We were listening to soul, boogie, funk.
So this is what, the tail end of the 70s, early 80s?
Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely. So that's always been like our foundation.
Late 70s, wasn't it?
Yeah, very late 70s. And then
I think one summer. What summer was it you went to New York?
I went to New York.
On a family holiday.
I went in 1979. Yeah. First family holidays, 1979, to New York. And that's when we came back with people like Chic.
Mm-hmm. But even though we already knew Chic through my dad and everything, because my dad would go to concerts. Sure. And he'd take me and my brother and sister to the concerts with him, even though we weren't old enough. And he took me to see Minnie Jackson once, and he was like, "Oh, we got to get out of here."
Yeah,
she was like, "She was going for it." I was about 11, and he was like, "Oh my god, we got to get out of here." But he took me to see so many artists, live artists.
God, my dad used to take me to Bristol. go to the fun fair, nothing like Millie Jackson.
Oh, so he used to take us. So we were totally into the whole live and seeing the band, everything. It was just amazing. My brother and my sister and myself.
We just knew good quality music.
Yeah. And there was a lot of it around then as well.
I mean, and obviously, you know, like coming into the hip hop years and just genuine music, we absorb a lot of American music. We had that growing up as kids, so it was always used to a certain quality.
Yeah.
So when we got into it, and me visiting the US, a family trip thing was like I said, 79, I must have been about 11 or 12. Giving away my age. Who cares? I'm proud. I kind of like heard the foundations of what hip hop was going to be and how it was going to come into my life. And I think it was back in 1985, when I got my first job. I was a chef at Ministry of Defence. So I was earning money. So like every year I could go to New York for my holidays. I mean, I'd go and literally spend 4 weeks shopping, eating, whatever, but specifically sitting down and taping radio stations.
Right.
Yeah, and bringing back cassette tapes.
Because obviously you had Kiss FM out there at the
time. Kiss FM, WBS, all that kind of stuff.
And it's like, when we started listening to American radio, the tapes that she taped in America, we started listening to those when she got back. And that's when we heard hip hop. We were like, because we started, it was like 82. We started listening, 81, 82, we were listening to the tapes.
Yeah.
But we didn't know
anybody else
was listening to this stuff.
Yeah.
We just thought it was just me and her. So we were sitting down listening to these radio stations and all these rappers and stuff. And we had that record, Funk Box.
Funk Box Party.
And we started rapping the Funk Box rap. Yeah. And we started listening to Sha Rock, Lisa Lee, Debbie D. And we started to think, God, there are girls out there doing this.
Yeah.
This is like, there are girls out there doing this.
No, that's right.
So we that's the album that we heard. And we started listening to we started hearing DJs' names on the tapes that Debbie brought back.
Yeah, because I know you left the ads in as well, because they were cool.
Yeah.
But
so she just let it run.
Yeah.
So
we'd circulate the tapes. And I used to take time to, you know, to re-record a tape and then give her a copy, handwrite on the, you know, the inlay sheet, the titles of the songs and everything. Yeah. And that's how music circulated back in those days.
So you were probably primarily sort of like the ones who were dishing out the hip-hop in South London. South London, yeah. Back in 82.
It's me. Yeah, forget everybody else.
Yeah. But, we're changing history as we go along,
absolutely,
folks.
Absolutely. So it's just through those early things that came to, and it was all organic. It was nothing, there was nothing that was kind of like, there was no kind of obviously corporate entities, because that world was a different world. Yeah. We loved records. We would go and touch and feel records and spend months, year in, year out, sitting at her dad's house or our parents, you know, our parents' house, sitting at going through records, looking at how they were dressed, reading all the credits, and like, this is music. But we never knew how it got to that stage. It was like, one day we're going to make records. We're going to be singers.
We're going to be singers. Yeah. We thought, it wasn't until we started hearing the tapes that we thought, you know,
this is rap.
This is whatever. So we started to listen and we started to experiment. First, we started to copy what Shower Rock, Lisa Lee, and Debbie D were doing on that. Yeah. So we started listening to that.
Me and Brad did that as well.
That's great.
On the Funk Box album, we could wrap that whole thing off, and we just started. And I think it was on one of the back of one of the albums, they had words like dope. What does it mean?
Fresh.
We were like, oh my God. So we were just looking at this stuff, and we used to hang out with some guys in our area who initially started breaking.
Right.
That's Robbie Wiz, who's a drummer. DJ Swing, who used to be called Disky D.
Right.
Because he was a body popper and a breaker. So we're all from the South London Battersea area.
Yeah.
And people like Robbie, we went to primary school together. Yeah. And him and Brian went to Spencer Park School together, so that's how we all kind of like connected as a group. And just literally in our little zone, back between Betsy Ryers, Clapham South era, we started creating a little scene.
So this is what I was going to ask. I mean, so how did it become that you obviously had all of this stuff from the US that you were picking up and bringing back, and then finding out that there was actually other people that were also into something
very early on?
You know,
I don't know how we put like a crew together of a load of girls, like about 13 or so girls, and we started putting on them the whole idea of hip-hop and b-girl and the elements of what a b-girl was and what a b-girl meant to us. A b-girl to us meant that we had to dress like boys. That's how we looked.
It wasn't too feminine, but
we didn't understand, and that was something we made up, because it wasn't like that in America.
We didn't know about imaging.
We didn't know anything like that. But the girls that we got together, they weren't too happy about it. They weren't really into it. So it was kind of like ended up being back down to just me and her again. But in the I don't know how we found ourselves in Covent Garden, but I think that one of the guys, Robert, I remember, who used to do the break dancing, because around our area we used to put a bit of cardboard out and we'd hang out there till the evening playing music and just the guys just breaking. And
what year was this?
This is like
probably 82, 83.
Yeah.
Maybe a little bit of 84.
So obviously like the electro albums were starting to come out.
I was working at the Ministry of Defence as chef. You were
college.
You were still at college and then you went into nursery.
But you know what? I think Robert connected Covent Garden, because he was a breaker. And he told us that he'd been down Covent Garden. And down Covent Garden, there's a scene.
That's like utopia, isn't it? It's Covent Garden.
We were like, what? He said, there's other people in Covent Garden. Like a lot.
And we started hearing about names like it wasn't even called DJ Business. We heard about someone called Billy.
Yeah.
You remember?
Yeah.
Like, it was a breaker. It's like,
I think we know him.
That dude, who later became our DJ.
We heard about London All-Star Breakers. Yeah. And we thought,
There were things happening. It was always
going to have to go down this. We went down there, and because we were scared, we were nervous, because obviously we come from our little scene, which is like about eight people, and we're coming into this other scene where we're seeing what. So we pretended that we were from New York, because we thought, well, we're just going to pretend we're from New York.
And it was a whole group of girls.
No one talked to us.
We dressed and remember our tops. We had these lovely t-shirts, these little vest top things. They weren't revealing vest tops in any way, shape, or form. Like that. I know, but they
understand. It wasn't a vest top.
It was a top.
Top. T-shirt.
Yeah, it was a t-shirt top.
No tassels or anything.
No tassels.
Right, okay, that's all right.
And it was white, and it had this luminous orange. I think it said USA 1 or something.
Yeah, it did.
I think we bought it from Topshop. Who knows?
I said that top.
Yeah, I did. Well, I cut it up there a bit.
But he did have tassels.
I can't remember what we had below, but it might have been trousers, jumpers, tie my lace, or we could, I can't remember.
We went down there
confidently with our little crew of girls and just walking around, hoping to bump into the others, you know? And we adopted this little persona thing, this American, we were just literally mucking about, talking American, and people like,
heads turning, like, and then you strike a conversation with just people, random people.
Yeah, everyone was talking
American.
To us, and that, we were like, we had to admit in the end.
Okay, eventually.
How long did it take?
It took like another couple of visits.
Oh, right.
Clapping
but I think for a while, months after that, people assumed that the coffee crew were from America. We just left them. It's up to them to decide, isn't it?
We had to
But do you remember that we made some friends down there? They had nothing to do with Billy and his crew and everything. Do you remember we met this group of guys? They came from Hornsey and they were called the Twilight.
Twilight Breakers.
Yeah, I don't know if they're even still alive now. Mm. But when we wrote our first rap, Our first rap was like a story telling from how we kind of like got to hip hop to all the people that we met.
Yeah. Mm.
And we mentioned the guys from up from a place called Hornsey. It's like we were spitting bars back then. I don't remember what their real names were, but I just remember those guys. And I think we just created our own little world, and we were happy with our own little world. Mm. And I think on the outside, people started hearing about these girls and that were rappers.
You know, being in our second or third visit to Covent Garden, we were told that if you go down into Charing Cross train station, there are guys who break down there.
Right.
So that we should go down there. Like somebody else had told us, because we were just into breaking, watching it. We've never wanted to break ourselves.
We did try.
But we loved to watch it. And
there was something so new at the time.
And we just thought, we heard that, you know, to be a breaker, you got to wear certain things. You got to wear Lee jeans. You got to wear name belts. So Debbie went to New York, got these things, got Puma States, came back, we put them on.
No sponsorship deal, we paid for ourselves.
We put on a Puma States, Lee jeans, put our name belts on, went back down, Covent Garden. Right, we came back down now. We were different. We're coming back down. So we got down to Covent Garden, and I'll never forget this day. We walked down into Charing Cross train station, and there was like a bend, and there was like a big space. And as we turned that corner, there was Live to Break, and our jaws just dropped, and the music and everything. We were just like, wow. And they were just like, where'd you get that stuff from that we were wearing? Yeah. Like,
it was like a movie. It was like a movie. And back then, we didn't have access to watching videos or seeing any kind of footage of what the hip hop scene is supposed to be. It's just that we knew there were, like you say again, there were others, and we needed to be with others.
Just mesmerized.
And I think within, we were so passionate about what we were doing, and I think. Mm. There was a serious side of it that, because I think because we always wanted to do something on stage, we wanted to perform. And when we've done our first rap, the first rap that we done was over White Lines. I can't remember how it came about. We was in a kitchen eating and drinking tea as usual. And we started to write this rap, which had no rhyme or reason. It didn't have any structure. I can't remember if it had a chorus. Mm. But we wrote and we wrote and we wrote and we wrote. It was about 15, 20 minutes long.
Mm.
And that was our first
rap. We didn't know about breaking it into verses. No. We didn't know anything.
We didn't have anyone to confer with to say, does this sound right? Mm. We could do it to ourselves. We create our own little world.
We didn't know anyone else. And then it wasn't until we went to a lyceum all day that we saw Family Quest on stage.
Yeah, was it Lyceum?
And I'm sure it was Lyceum all day or somewhere.
Somewhere we went.
Who
we
also
went
had a female front. MC.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
and we were like, Misha, wasn't it?
Yeah,
we
Mystery MC.
Like, whoa. And we loved Family Quest.
Yeah.
And we just thought, wow, that's how we're going to be. Yeah. We're going to be, we're going to be like Family Quest. And I don't know if that was the next one we went to was where Afrika Bambaataa and Soul Sonic Force came, but the first one was when we saw Family Quest.
Yeah, because it was all about the UK scene. I don't think it was even fussed about American artists, because we had something going on here. And as far as we're concerned, the acts that we're hearing about, they were cool. And that's our competition. And we're either going to meet them or be rivals, not in a horrible way looking back, because everything was healthy competition.
Mm. Yeah.
And we also always position ourselves like, just because we're girls, we don't want anyone to just say you're good for girls. You're good because you're good.
And were there any others at the time, obviously, because there were a few obviously female MC groups in the 80s
from the UK,
but when you were there, was there any competition?
No, the only person was Mr. MC, and from the off
she was the only one.
From the off, we always had respect for her, and that was some source of inspiration.
Mm. And she could freestyle. Yeah. And she could freestyle properly.
Yeah.
And she just had that flow. And when you see her perform, she'd be like...
She was just excellent. Like, wow. And they were the only group that we looked at as, inspiration or having... And it was from there that we started to meet other rappers.
Mm.
But they were mainly guys.
I'm thinking about our first, like the whole... the Battersea connection and how we started doing things in our little neighbourhood, and that's where, you know, the likes of London Posse's were, the Harlem Shoe Shufflers, who was DJ Swing and Robert and other members from the area. We all used to gather at Batsy Town Hall. That was like our hub. It was like a place where you could go. There was a room, and the guys always used to use it, literally set up with their boombox. Sammy,
and practice breaking,
and we just used to go and tag along as you do, because we're rappers, aren't we?
Of course.
So it's not like we took ownership of Batsy Town Hall, and we used to go to little events, do little community things, and da da da. And one day we were there, and there was some event going on, and we went down, and we were running around because obviously we owned the place, yeah. And this guy came up to us, and he goes, "What do you girls do?" Like, "We rap." "Okay, then come in here. We're going to do an interview." We're like, okay.
And what year was this?
Good Lord, what year was this? I'm trying to think if I even was working then. Maybe I was. Who knows? Or was I at college? I can't remember the year. I can't remember the year, but it might come to me as we start doing time.
Before 85.
Yeah, it was before. God, we haven't touched on 85 yet, have we?
No, it was before 85.
Guys.
Before 85. Yeah. It was like,
so,
you know,
82. Yeah, so he took us into a room, and this guy, his name was Sid Burke. He used to have a show on LBC called Rice and Peas. He used to come on Sundays. So he interviewed us, and first interview ever, I'd imagine. God, I can't remember what questions were, what answer, but we obviously thought we were acting artists.
But we were nobody. We'd done nothing. We just happened to be sitting there, and he's like, "What do you do?" And we were like, "Oh, we're rappers." We were anything. We just made it. We weren't making it up, but we just like, we're, you know, so
we hadn't gone professional yet, put it that way.
We were nobody. Yeah.
So we've done an interview, it went out, and that's when we started getting a lot of calls for like local shows and things in the park, and like GLC had events on, so little, you know, things that were relevant to your area. We'd always go and do stuff in like little, you know, like community centres locally in Battersea, in Wandsworth, in Brixton. And from there, you know, just things just kind of like escalated, and we'd manage our own selves, people call us. We had jobs, I think, at that point. So doing a gig at the weekend and getting an extra 20 quid or 50 quid in your pocket, that's like tax-free.
It's a lot of money.
That's a lot of money.
But, you know, everything we did, from that point, we were asked to do these little shows here and there. We just stood, literally, with the mic and just rapped. Don't ask us to move.
You didn't jump on tables like you did in some of the later videos.
We didn't know about
that kind of stuff. So we literally would just stand there and rap to the music. Because to us, that's what we were supposed to do. And that's what it was about. So we didn't know about any kind of performance in rap. We didn't know that.
Stage presence.
We just did that. And we got asked to do something at Brixton Town Hall. Oh, God. Yeah, and that.
It was like a family event. It was a family variety show. There might have been magicians on, dancers, whatever on.
It was everything.
There were stars in their eyes.
Exactly. It was in the hall, wasn't it? And as far as concerned, I'm sure the lights were on all the way through the whole event. It's that kind of event, but it was local. So we invited our parents down. Robbie and Brian came down as our support, and da-da-da. And we done this show, man. Was that the first time we wore red and white outfits?
Yeah, we had these red things that said WMACC, Warm Milk and Cookie Crew. What the hell? We don't know. We just did it. Because we thought that sounded cool. Obviously,
it was Dino.
But we thought, Warm Milk and Cookie Crew. That's what we're called. So this was on our backs. It was on everything.
And it was all about red and white. Our branding was red and white.
Okay.
The beads was all the Cookie Crew.
Oh, my God.
If you saw anybody with beads, you thought it was in the Cookie Crew.
Right.
So we were rocking the beads. I also think I always rocked the red and white beads. You had a nice selection. But our stage presence was like...
Don't say that bit.
No, we've got to tell them.
No.
It's hip-hop. No, it is hip hop.
The top is enough.
Yeah. Right, we had a top on. We were flying.
Don't mention what was on the bottom.
All right, okay.
We had white high top trainers with red fat laces, and they were cool.
Yeah, okay. We made an effort. We knew about.
We always wore our fat laces in everything. We never ever went anywhere without them. We had our fat laces at all times.
So we've done a variety of stuff. Nothing.
How did that show go down?
It was wicked.
It was wicked.
We were good.
Someone must have a video, surely.
There's got to be some grainy film or something.
Yeah,
we've done good for that time in the era, actually. You know,
we did the breaking competition, the body popping breaking in Lewisham, Catford.
Stanley Hall, Norwood. Yeah, we've done so many local things, but to us, that's like in Wembley.
We were Prince. What the hell?
Yes.
I never forget that. I thought, what are we doing that
for? We had a white shirt.
Yeah, don't talk about it while we were in. But
we were dumb. It was
horrendous. It was until, then we started thinking, we can't go anywhere without our Lee jeans on and name belt. Because we've got to stop that. You've got to stop doing that.
So I think we just evolved. As time went on, we evolved. And I think it was good. I think we had an eye for what we wanted to look like and how we want to present ourselves, how we wanted people to perceive us from a very young age. You know, and I think we just started to make a name within the area. No internet, no mobile phones, none of that Wi-Fi nonsense.
And then Covent Garden happened.
Yeah, you see,
Covent Garden was happening, but we didn't go often. So we went down there, we hooked up, met Live to Break, hanging out with some of them quite a lot. And
I think we became very patriotic about South London and keeping in that zone.
And once we kind of got in with the Covent Garden crowd, we started, you'd go to Covent Garden, and say you'd go in the morning, and by midday you're in Wolverhampton.
Right.
Going to see some breakers.
The B-boys up there.
Yeah, when we went to Wolverhampton and met Bubbles, the female breaker, we were like, come on. This is it now.
So obviously, at the time there was stuff going on all over the UK.
We weren't doing anything. We were just known as being rappers. Mm. We've done nothing. We've made no music, nothing. So we would just go in from place to place. We used to go with Sipo, rest in peace, and Pete. And we, Pervez, Breaker. And we used to go,
we'd go to
Birmingham. And then we go see break. If they say there's all day down at Rock City, Nottingham, we go down there, and that's how we hooked up with Rock City Crew, because we love Rock City Crew. And when we arrived at the all day at Rock City Crew, I'll never forget. We walked in that door, all of like Covent Garden came in that door, like everybody who'd come from Covent Garden. We walked in that door, and they obviously know each other. And I remember one of Rock City, which is Pepsi. Looked over and we walked in and we had our Lee jeans on, name belt, Kangol hat, Gazelles, and I just heard him go, oh my god! He's like, where have you come from? It was fantastic. Yeah. And that's how we hooked up with them, and we just loved them.
We just started, I suppose, travelling out more, and there were shows happening in those places. We're getting more for those shows. So we made a connection with people outside of London, and you know, it just became, the scene just started to grow, and people doing, you know, more things, doing stuff together. Hip hop jams were starting to happen, and you know, there was all like small venues, mostly go Shady Grove, just little clubs, little things. And it was all like flies here, or just word of mouth. You kind of knew where to go.
So you obviously sort of like went out of London and met loads of other crews. Mm. What about the other crews, north, west and east of London?
Of London?
I'm just saying, you know, because obviously there's going to be a rivalry between London crews. Yeah, I'm not trying to steer or anything like that. But
at the time, that was serious. That's like war.
Obviously, you had Ladbroke Grove. You had, Tottenham, and you had,
there wasn't a rivalry. That rivalry didn't happen until...
You started recording?
Yeah.
Okay.
Rivalry did not happen until we started recording. Yeah. Because before that, I wasn't aware of any rivalry on anything.
I think everyone is just doing their own thing, and everybody wanted to be good at what they done. Mm. And as you would, you think you're better than the next thing, you know, and it's up to you to go out there and perform and for the audience to decide. But when it got to a stage when we, you know, signed a deal and all that kind of stuff, you know, we got a lot of backlash. And we felt it personally, because
it was horrible.
You're so homed in with your hometown and the scene and not, what's the word?
I suppose quite young as well, to take that sort of thing.
We were young, but was very, everything was about London and going to America and this, that, and that. You sold out, this, that. We took that shit seriously.
Yeah, it was
but
really
at the same
personal.
Time, there was a part of us that we knew, whatever we're doing, this is actually our business. This is our work. We were a company. We were set up as a limited company. We had management. Mm. We had a responsibility to our lives and
but
our career.
But you know, we've got to think before that. About
that's what I was going to say. Rewind a little bit. How did it go from...
Just get stuff thrown at us.
Well, you know what happened? You know, Deb, we don't need to go into that. That was once.
I'm
sorry about that. I didn't mean to.
And that was a Stetsasonic gig, and we'll talk about
Electric.
That. That was once.
And they got dealt with.
That was dealt with. Yeah. Leave it alone.
But how did... how did you get from touring...
touring the world.
I'll tell you what happened. My dad, who was the music man, used to get a magazine called Blues and Soul.
Plenty of those in here.
And he'd get it every week. And as he'd get that, we'd look, you know, we'd read through it, take the posters out, put them on a wall, whoever it was, whatever, read through that. And we could read about different things that were happening. And I don't know how we heard about this rap competition happening at Wag Club, but
it was
something through and through someone else. There was this rap competition, and we
it was Westwood, because Westwood used to do it. I don't know how we knew about it because we didn't know Westwood at that point. But he used to do the didn't he used to write a little hip hop column in Blues?
We would look if he mentioned us in the hip hop column, because he'd mention people from Covent Garden and he'd write about what was happening.
He had a top 10 people who are down in hip-hop scene in London. So every week you check whether you're in it.
Yeah, because you want to be on the down list. You know, you're on there. So this was like, this was 1985. And
February.
Yeah, we heard about this competition. And Robert, one of our friends, he said, you know, you guys, you could win this. And we hadn't even been down there. We hadn't done anything. We were like, we're not going to do that. He said, go down there. You could go down, you know, just go down there and see. So we went down there, no intention at all to be in this competition. No way to be in this competition.
They were there to, in fact, we put our name down, didn't we?
Yeah, initially, we put our name down. And then like about 50 minutes later, we went and took our name off the list because we were so scared of being
the
in this competition.
There was amazing.
And we went in there and they were all like different rappers, DJs in there. And we just thought, you know what, we're out of our depth here. Mm. We're just not at this level. And we're not ready to do this. Then we went, we took our name off the list. And I think the guy who had the list had come back and said, girls, you know, there's no girls in the competition. You know, just go on to put your name down. You know, you never know what happened. But, you know,
well,
so
I think we went there. And I think it was one of those things where you go down and you put your name down to enter it. And it was... I think that particular night, the first night, it was so busy, so many people put their name down to enter the competition that they split it over 2 weeks.
Yeah.
So we were supposed to go on that week, but then they decided to split it into solo artists and then crews.
Oh, yeah.
So that day we were lucky because it was too packed. They couldn't fit anybody else, you know, to go on the bill.
Yeah.
So I think we had that week to kind of regroup.
Shat ourselves that whole
to get
week.
To, I think we're probably ready and hot. We're just nervous. We've never done anything to a hip hop crowd on that capacity.
Yeah.
So we went back the second week, and I remember the bouncer that used to work there, and I'm trying to remember his name, but I can see his face. But
huge guy.
Yeah, he always used to give us hassle when we to go raving there because we are underage or with passports.
We looked a bit too young.
Always
to get
gave us
it.
Hassle, but always kind of let us in. I got made a cup of tea that day.
We were so
nervous. And then it came to our bit and we were called to go on stage, and I was picked up and put on the stage. The stage probably wasn't any bigger than this space here.
But you had to
pretty small.
You had to lift her up.
Lifting her on the stage.
And
the DJ box was right beside us. I'm trying to think who played our music first. Was it Robbie or did whoever the DJ was on that night?
Tim put it on because he asked us what we wanted and we said we wanted Planet Rock.
So we had Planet Rock and we had, was it B-Boy's Breakdance?
Yeah.
Was the second track that we'd done.
Yeah.
And we started rapping, mate. It was the way, up to this day, just thinking about it, gives me kind of shivers.
When that Planet Rock went, dun, 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 we're like, are you people,
that's it.
Oh my God.
We just started rapping from beginning to end.
Fast.
And I think we were just so on it, and it was just so consistent.
The thing is, we'd worked that rap day in.
There's no mistakes.
Yeah. We only had two raps.
That had choruses, mate.
Oh, right.
And we did them day in and day out.
Killed it.
In my dad's front room, all day, every day, we did those raps. So we knew them like the back of our hand, and we knew each other. Obviously, we'd grown up together so well. So when that beat came in, we were on, and we didn't stop.
It was a feeling. It was like an out-of-body experience, just the crowd.
And then we slowed down, like that beat, we slowed down. We went, God, we are the Cookie Crew. And
killed it!
Not the warm milk and cookies. That would have been a bit of a tongue twister, wouldn't it?
Exactly. So we just killed it. And then the guys were literally, I don't remember.
Did Johnny go that night?
Cutmaster Swift on a man.
Because it was Robert.
Imperial Mixers.
Johnny. Yeah. It was them, and they weren't even called that then. Were they?
Probably not.
Maybe they were, but
Imperial
obviously
Mixers
we were always like Johnny and Robert. Yeah. Or whatever. So they were the ones, like Cutmaster Swift, who was like, you guys need to, we can do this.
We come from Battersea.
Because that's where Swift is from, isn't it?
We all went down and...
They were literally our support network. I don't remember our feet touching the ground after that because the crowd was going crazy. And it was like, and then when it was read out that we won, oh my God. I'm like, this is incredible. Yeah, it was the most. And going home that night, we must have
because it was a crowd thing. You had to cheer. They had to cheer for what group?
Do you remember any of the other groups that were playing? Or?
I can't remember. I
obviously, you just blew them out of the water, so they just retired. Yeah. They retired.
That night, they put down the mic.
Yeah.
There were loads.
Yeah, there was a lot of people on that night.
And I think
lot.
Westwood called out everyone's name. Then when he called out Cuckoo, crowd went
crowd
mad.
Did go mad.
And excellent. Then
yeah, no, we were. It was good.
And we had a trophy.
Yeah.
I was trophy.
1985.
Really?
Who's got the trophy? We shared it.
Well, let's not talk about what happened to the trophy. Trophy's gone.
The trophy went in a nasty accident. Okay. No, it was a horrible accident.
Okay. But it's gone.
I tried to salvage it, but it was melted.
It melted.
Yeah.
But it was
high like quality lost. Stuff then.
Yeah. It wasn't Oscar quality, put it that way. So yeah, it was probably a fire hazard in itself. Yeah. But hey.
And then there was a picture of us. What the best thing that ever happened was the following week. There was a picture of us in Blues and Soul.
Oh hell,
my dad. Blues and Soul every month or whatever. And I was like,
it was a big deal. I don't remember how we got home that night. We must have floated home. Yeah.
And my dad just didn't get
it. And on top of that, we got a little gold envelope that had £200 in it.
Oh, nice.
In today's money.
That's not about the £200.
£200 in today's money.
That's a couple of grand, isn't it?
A couple of grand.
That's right.
Yeah, so it was kind of like, I think that's where, you know, that's the original internet right there. That's when we became viral. You know,
right.
That's where it happened, and we were just so proud. And then people started hearing about us, and then we became credible. Was accepted amongst, you know, the other fold within other parts of London.
Other rappers in London. You know,
and also I think it's the way we carried ourselves. We really wanted to be respected as for our talent. I don't think we even had on our radar about where girls we can use it to our ability. It just wasn't about that.
Sure.
Yeah. And sometimes when other females were on the scene, people that we didn't know. Sometimes the guys didn't appreciate them because they didn't come with the right attitude, you know. And you know, I remember that point, that time when Pepsi told us that some girls once came up to Nottingham or went into a gig in Nottingham Rock City. They got in free because they said they were the Cookie Crew.
Right.
Yeah. They said some girls there. They said they're you lot.
And you rang us. Yeah.
But you know, it's just all cool. And then we started going to Wolverhampton, to Birmingham, Manchester, Nottingham, and it was all like impromptu kind of trips. And you know, we could hang with the cool guys now. You know, we knew all of Live to Break and London All Stars, and so when we arrived, it's like, okay, these, you know,
cooks,
cooks, we're the
that
cooks.
That was our name. The cooks are here.
Yeah.
Or the cooks, are the cooks going or whatever. You know, it was just really cool.
So
really nice.
We began to live and breathe.
Yeah. Everything changed.
And was it just two of you at the time, or was it?
No, it was just,
well, it started to deplete rapidly. I don't think the other females, the other girls in the group, was as passionate about what we were. And I just think that all that was. It wasn't a case of you
some
got kicked
of them
out
were our cousins.
Yeah,
we still see them.
Just drag them on stage. Come on.
Yeah, they always say, remember when we used to make us do that stuff?
I think we forced them to wear the same tops as us and wear the thing. It was nice at the time because we had a nice little crew going and wanted to go clubbing. Yeah. We went in force, you know. Mm. We went to
because we were nervous a lot of the time about, you know, we were young, just going out or just.
We always wanted an ultimate female crew, and what
we never
that
really got it in the end, but you know.
But you pretty much were, even though there was only two of you.
But we wanted, our dream was to have the whole thing, Breakers, the DJ, everything.
So
we never got that.
Like a Cookie sound system.
Foundation.
It never happened, but it was a dream. Yeah. It was a dream. But, you know, after winning the competition and doing little bits and pieces here and there, we went, we went...
Also, on top of the £200, there was a recording contract tied to that.
Oh yeah,
we went to a meeting. We're like, we didn't know anything about that world. The key thing is we weren't interested. Mm. We were just like, we're accepted into the fold of hip hop.
Yeah, that was more important to us. We turned down the recording contract.
Because can't remember what that
we didn't have
was.
A clue what the hell we would record, and we hadn't written. We weren't rewriting like that, and. We needed to spend more time either writing and getting to know, you know, we were just happy that we'd won and we got our £200 and our trophy and that was it. We were happy. So I think everything to us from that point on was going out. Hip hop jams. Mm. That was everything.
So how long between winning that competition and signing up?
There's a really important gig before that happened, and that was the Shaw Theatre in London. So that was like a major gig for us, and a major teaching point for us, because we
everything from that point was about going out, hip-hop jams, breaking battles, watching breaking battles, being involved in breaking battles, who was better, who was the best breakers. Mm. We were totally involved in that conversation. Mm. That was everything. And a load of us went out one night. We went to, in the West End, Run DMC.
At Busby's.
And Run DMC were going to be there. So that was huge. And we were like, well, you know, you've got to put on your shell tops. And we're going down and everything. So we've gone down goose to jackets. Run DMC. And Debbie been to you and got goose jackets. So we had the big goose with the fur.
Nice.
Big leather thing. We've gone down now.
The leather goose jackets.
Yeah. We had a red one, black
red
one.
Red, white fur. We had all the styles.
God, these are all the things that I wanted. You could never afford.
Same. Should have called up Devin.
I know.
Exactly.
So we've gone down to see Run DMC, and while we're in there, just dancing, mucking about with this woman comes up to us. It's like a middle-aged, normal woman, mousy sort of hair. Her name was Jean Davenport. Mm. Gone from us now, rest in peace, Jean. But Jean Davenport, she worked at the Shaw Theatre, and she had put on like major gigs in the past of like jazz artists. She brought people to this country no one had brought here before.
We didn't know
anything about her, but we know this now. But we didn't know, and we just looked at this woman. She was like, she's from up north. She's like, are you Cookie Crew? We were like, yeah. And she goes, I'm putting on a show at the Shaw Theatre, and it's all going to be hip hop. And she said, I've got Africa Bambaataa coming.
This wasn't the one that was in Bombing, the documentary,
yeah.
Was it?
Yeah, the footage from that was in Bombing.
Yeah.
So okay. She goes, I've got Africa Bambaataa coming, DJ Red Alert, IKC, Lisa Lee,
Brim the Graffiti. Brim
the Graffiti. That's right,
coming
yeah.
over,
yeah.
right? So, and I want you to do it. We were like, okay.
This is our opportunity for Hollywood now.
We're like, right, okay. We're trying to get our head around that. Now we're thinking, all right, okay. Red Alert.
African
Bambaataa. Red Alert. The
MC Lisa Lee.
Red Alert.
Lisa Lee as well.
Yeah. We're just like, we said yes, but you know, typical us, straight away regretted it.
We were nervous. Mm. We were nervous. That means we're going to be on a stage with American artists.
We've never been on stage with American artists before. We'd never made a connection with American hip hop before that.
Mm. The UK had co-signed us and given us that tick, that's fine.
Mm. We'd not done that before.
I mean, UK hip hop was still in its infancy, whereas American hip hop had already made it to a certain degree.
Exactly. Yeah. And, you know, this is where we were to meet Bam, Africa Bambaataa, because this was big for us because it was Zulu Nation. And after meeting Bam, we became good friends with him, and he made us Zulu Queens and stuff. But he was everything. He was the godfather. Mm. He was it. So we'd seen the Soul Sonic Force at Lyceum before. We'd seen them dressed up in all their powwow, Mr. Biggs,
everything. MC Glow.
So we'd seen them. So we're at this Run DMC concert, and we're thinking, okay, so we're gonna. So she said, this is the rehearsal time.
I think we rehearsed about 2 weeks.
You need to be there at this time, blah, blah, blah. So we've gone in. So we've gone down there to rehearse, and we rehearsed a lot, but then there was this day where it was like a sound check using the mics. So we were like, okay.
Almost a dress rehearsal kind of situation with a fake audience. But
so we've gone out onto the stage to do this mic check thing. And as we walk out, sitting in the auditorium just chatting to each other, not paying no attention to us, but they were having a talk, and was Red Alert, IKC, Bambaataa, and I just thought,
Lisa Lee, can't forget Lisa Lee.
Why is Lisa Lee standing there? Jazzy Joyce. She's on the stage at the decks, and I just walk out there and I just thought, somebody just needs to take me off the stage and take me home, because I should not be here. So I'm looking at them, and I just looked at her, and I just thought, I just can't do this. I just cannot rap in front of these people. And I knew that I had to. So the music comes on.
We're turning to mannequins. That was the style of our performance anyway. We didn't know anything about
stage.
Let's walk past each other, let's this.
So we start rapping. We're doing our rap. The rap is cool, actually. The rap was good. We had two good ones.
We rehearsed so tightly.
Yeah, and our rapping was very tight. We've always been really tight. We'd never made mistakes on our rap.
Laughed at me.
That was a gig.
And that was in my later years where I shouldn't be making mistakes.
Yeah. You started doing a whole different route. That was when Dazzle was our DJ.
Ladies, can we get back to the stuff like that? That was funny.
We were told off actually. I can start laughing. The man wasn't impressed with us. Yeah. But anyway, we never really made mistakes.
Promoter.
And went out on the stage. We got there. We started rapping. I don't know what we're rapping over, but we started rapping. Did the rap. So the rap's finished, we're standing there, and Africa Bambaataa goes. Yeah, but he started talking.
Oh, right, yeah.
Bam started talking to the others. We knew they were talking about us. And Jazzy Joyce said, you know, girls, you know, why don't you try and walk around?
Use the stage!
When you're rapping.
Use the stage!
And we were like, okay. She's like, use the stage! When you're rapping,
we thought cheeky bugger. We thought,
who are you? Tell me.
Yeah. We were like, okay. And Red Alert saw that we were so embarrassed and so kind of like, oh, we came off the stage, and he took us to like where the room was, and he sat us down. He was like, girls, this is what you got to do. You got to come back tomorrow, and you got to come back correct. You got to go away, and you got to come back. And he was just like the nicest
individual
person that I, you know, because obviously we looked at these people in awe, and he said, you got to come back, and you got to come back correct tomorrow. You got to go away. You got to use the stage. We'll come down. We didn't do that kind of stuff. We just stood behind a DJ booth and rapped. We didn't know that if we went out on stage on our own, we thought we could do the same.
Yeah.
So like, no, even though we'd seen Run DMC like a few weeks ago,
I think we were just nervous. No. We weren't confident about
so we went
about performance as a whole, you know, dancing, that kind of stuff. Like, we're rappers.
We went home that night.
We
moved the furniture in the sitting room, and we were like, we're gonna use this freaking room. Right, we are walking up and down, we're using it,
interacting,
looking at each other. We didn't look at each other when we rapped. We were just like, she's over there. I'm doing my bit here. Yeah. I don't need to look at her because I know what I'm doing. So we started to look at each other and everything, and they
and flip the words and everything.
Yeah, we didn't do that, and they taught us. They told us, you better go home, sort yourself out, and come back because you're gonna look stupid. So we went away. We came back. We went back to the sound check again, and I remember standing at the side of the stage and thinking, we're gonna go out there and kill this now. Because I remember the feeling the day before was just one of fear and wanting to go home, and I can't believe that these people, you know, Lisa Lee is out there. So we went out there and we did kill that. And they were like, that's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about now. And we were like, thank you.
So we just that built up our confidence, and we realised, you know, this is what performance is all about. So everything we've done is all about your stage presence.
Yeah.
And that's still a big thing for me now. I get upset when I see any kind of group on stage and they're just disorganised, bumping into each other. It's like stage presence, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, you know,
they taught us.
Yeah. And how did the actual night go down?
Oh, it was fantastic. Wicked. Sure, yeah. I think that, the sure thing, didn't it go over a few days? So it's like a matinee show, evening show for like a week or something.
So we were doing two shows a day.
Yeah.
Right. And, I did not realise you guys were there. I'm sorry.
Were you there?
No, it's just that obviously I've seen bombing because I was graffiti artist back in the day. Yes. So that was my thing.
Yeah, a clip of us doing this for my performance.
One little clip in bombing.
That's right.
And we had knitted gloves if you look closely.
Oh, man, the gloves I didn't want to talk about.
Because I remember that bit where you're going like that.
Yeah.
And then it goes to the B-boys playing cricket and all that sort of stuff in it. Yeah.
On the bill, we had people like Basil and Darnell.
Body Poppers. Yeah, doing their stuff. Amazing.
It was just
amazing.
Thinking about Shaw Theatre and thinking about hip hop in that whole capacity, in that arena. And every show was sold out, and kids were there. Everybody wanted to come and talk to you afterwards. It was just a nice feeling. And then we, you know, it's the first time we actually connected with the US and realised this, you know.
And it was through that, it was Jean Davenport who put that show on. She became our manager in the end, but she was the one who
we forced her to be our manager. She was
like,
and she invested in us, literally invested her own money. Don't know what that is in modern times, but she did. And then we ended up, you know. Rock the House happened, and that's the thing that opened up the door for us for getting
So how did that happen?
Tim Westwood knew the Beatmasters. They weren't called the Beatmasters at that point. They were a team, like a little production company that made Adverts for TV.
Oh, right. So not even in the scene or anything.
No, well,
I mean, it was hip house, wasn't it? So
no, they had nothing. They weren't anything. They weren't recorded.
They just made adverts for television.
And they needed some voiceovers. So Westwood
for hot chocolate or something.
Ribena, wasn't it?
Ribena, yeah. And Tim.
The hot chocolate and cookie.
Some random brand out there. So yeah, he recommended us, and then
because they said, oh, you know, we could do with some girls rapping on this advert that we're making.
Ribena,
and
it?
He said, I know some girls who could write a rap for the Ribena ad, or, you know, and you could use their voices, blah, blah, blah. I'll call them up. So he told us, we went down there.
Down Water Street.
We did the advert, and that was the first time we'd seen like a studio set up. Mm. We'd not seen that before. So with them making the music for the ad and everything, we were in there just watching
everything they were doing.
And they were doing all stuff. We were just watching everything they were doing. And we said, we said to them, we do shows sometimes and we don't have a DJ to do shows music. With us. We don't have a DJ. So we have to put our music on the DAT machine.
No, well, didn't have that.
We had a tape or something. Yeah. And they said to us, you know, well, if you tell us, we'll help you out. Like, if you tell us the music that you want, we can, like, cut it into bits.
And
so you just get the instrumental.
Yeah.
And we can repeat it and put it on, like, a DAT thing or tape for you to do your shows.
Yeah.
We were like, wow, okay. Mm. So that's how we started using them.
Mm.
And we'd say, we got a show, can you do this music for us? They'd be like, yeah, yeah. And then one day, the guy, forget his name, one of the guys, he said, we should make a song together. And we were like, yeah, because we're doing all this. Let's make a song. Let's do something. So they started playing around with music that they thought of and stuff. And they said, you know, can you rap over this? We were like, yeah, we can rap over anything.
And were you obviously aware that, obviously, because house music was pretty brand new at the time as well.
It wasn't hardcore hip-hop, so we didn't have a clue about it.
Yeah.
We didn't have a clue what it was.
Yeah.
We just said we can rap over anything. Yeah. Just give us what it is and we'll rap it.
Yeah.
So they gave us the music. We wrote it. And then the first
mix of it, initially the music was, it was a hip-hop feel to it. It was hip-hop because that's what we're about. That's what the feel was, the vibe was. And I think, you know, that when we done that, it wasn't like we're working towards a release date or anything. They just had a track, played around with it a few times, different mixes, and we listened to it, oh, that's nice. And then you go back the following week, different sound. And it just evolved into this track that was Rock the House.
Yeah. Which we weren't that keen on at the end of it.
It was a project that we used to,
you know, Beatmasters were really cool people, and that was what they wanted to do. And we said, I remember one point saying they could put the track out, but don't put our names on it because we didn't want our name to be associated with it.
Mm.
And they were like, yeah, but people are going to want to know, you know.
I think they wouldn't do it as like a white label type thing, wasn't it?
Yeah, nobody was really rapping or putting out music, like not girls anyway. So it was like, and we were like, oh man, because, you know, people are going to diss us and whatever.
Yeah, we're very protective about our reputation.
We just thought, oh man.
Mm. I think they had.
But at the end of the day, it's the best thing happened to us because that's how we got our deal.
Yeah. Yeah.
But we were totally like, oh my God, you know, it's going to be a bit embarrassing and it's not really hip hop.
So we were careful how it was placed. And I think they got some white labels or TPs pressed up. And it probably went out to a few DJs.
Yeah.
And it got picked up. Mm-hmm. I think probably in the clubs, reactions from DJs, and they pick up on stuff like that. Mm. Mark Moore.
S Express.
Yep. Mm. He picked up on the record because maybe he was busting it in a club and the crowd reaction was great. And it's like, you know, you investigate it further. Mm. So it just kind of like time went on. And I think he obviously had contacts with Rhythm King. So I think he took the record to Rhythm King.
Right.
So that's when it all started kind of rolling. And the phone calls start happening. We want to have meetings. We're like, meetings?
Yeah, we thought, why are we having meetings? Because we're not part of Beatmasters.
And we just wasn't interested in that side of anything.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's like, but this is a hit, girl. And we said, well, I think we went and spoke to people. And we weren't rude in any way.
I remember somebody from Radio 1 called my dad's house. Well, called my house where I was living. And my dad was like, somebody on the phone from the radio. And he says he's live on the radio. and then he said that you don't want nothing to do with this song and he wants to talk to you about it. And I was like, God,
and then I had to reshare something. Then I had to do an interview to explain why, because the record went out and it just went up the charts.
And it blew up, didn't it?
It just done its thing. Behind our backs, we didn't know what was happening.
We did nothing. Yeah. We never ever performed that.
Never.
That
You're
song.
In your kitchen drinking your cup of tea.
Right.
Yeah, we've never performed it. And so even if you
people would ask us to rap it, we're like, we can't even have no words.
So I think we had to justify why we didn't like the record and this, that, and the other. And
that was a bit bad, innit, for Beatmasters. Not the thing, but they understood because we just weren't. We said in the beginning, this is not really our thing, and this is your thing, and you need to take that and go. That's not our. It's not our.
It's done its job, and we did disown it. But it is the record that.
But then you got the second track.
What, Females? That was our.
That didn't really go the way we wanted.
We redeemed ourselves on that. That was a cool track, but we had issues with artwork and certain things.
Yeah, we had a few issues.
But, you know, we had to make sure before we were going to go into that world of making records that this is what Cookie Crew is.
Did you have much more input with the making of Females in regards to, you know, with the samples that were used and stuff like that?
Yeah, we used to bring music to them. We used to bring music to them that we like. So, the whole sample thing was. But if you're not in that environment of producing tracks that are hip-hop, it's going to come out the way it sounded.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
It was harder than what it was and what it is. You know, we liked that record. We enjoyed performing it. And it was, you know, it's the early years.
Yeah.
Early years. And, you know, we were doing gigs, we were doing stuff. And I think even when Rock the House got to charts, I think Beatmaster performed it on Top of the Pots by
himself. They asked us to go on Top of the Pops.
We used to get books.
And that was what the phone call was about, because we turned down Top of the Pops for Rock the House. Yeah. But we just thought.
And we got shows on the strength of.
Because it got to like number five, didn't it?
Yeah. And when we were starting to do shows, and this is like further down, but I'm going to come back. A lot of promoters, we should book you on the strength of your hit record.
Yeah.
Mm. So when we used to go and do shows and it wasn't in our set.
And not do Rock the House.
The managers would come to us saying, girls, you're going to. It's like, I think I'm sure we've done it one time and we were laughing so much because we didn't know the word.
I don't know what we did, but
the promoter was upset because we didn't include it in our set, but it wasn't what we're about. And, you know, obviously things change and just time went on and then.
We never ever used it in our set.
We never used it in our set.
Never.
But off the strength of that, that's where we got labels interested. Yeah. So we went for the whole process of this label's interest, and our managers say, you know, got to have a meet with this company, that company, and then the whole publishing thing came. We were like, what the hell is publishing? And we used to go to meetings, and we'd be sitting with big lawyers and whatever. Me and her sitting on the couch, like just sleeping.
A load of them.
Because we didn't understand, but we trusted our management.
But they were like the best management ever.
So we got the best deals, and then we got publishing. Now I understand publishing. If I knew back then what the whole thing was, but you know, after we have to count our blessings for the deal that we got and how it was treated, everything was above water, and you know, it still looks after us to this day. So
everything was brilliant. But Jean, our manager, she had to, every meeting she went to with record companies, that because of that she had to say, you do know that they don't want to make music like Rock the House, because our deal was on the strength of that.
Sure.
So we had to go with the label that in the end who said that we didn't have to make music like Rock the House, which was Pete Tong. And that was they were the ones that said that we didn't have to do that.
Yeah. Just give us our three singles and
They said that, so we were like, okay. So that's why we went with FFRR. Yeah.
And how did you hook up with, well, pretty much that's a Sonic in regards to that. I mean, that's a hell of a jump, ladies.
We've always been fans. I think after we'd signed with Lana Records.
You know what? Can I just go back? You know when Billy was talking about going to the music seminars? We used to go to the new music seminars.
And
you'd see all of. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think we went to two.
Yeah.
What years were they?
Oh, God.
It would have been post 88.
But you know how you can tell I don't know if you can tell by this, but my favourite story is going into the MC battle. I think Grandmaster Flash was in it.
What, Melly Mel?
Showing his muscles. No, Melly Mel, we kept doing that.
Was that the one where he battled King Sun and lost or something?
Yes, I think that was it. But I don't know if we walked in there and the MC battle was on. And once again, we were like, wow, we're looking around us at all the. And we had, I think we were signed. We had done some interviews because we were signed like for our first album.
Yeah.
And we walked in and these big guys, all I can tell you is the size of them.
We went to
a
club night.
And we were standing with this club and these guys tapped me on the shoulder. I turned around and he said, are you the Cookie Crew? And I said,
I'm like, yeah, who wants to know?
I was like, yes. And he said, you did an interview and you said that you like my song. And I was like, really? Who are you? He said, and I said, who are you? He said,
after three.
We're the kings of pressure. I was like, listen.
That was it. It's all over.
I said, you know how to reach us. It's like, yeah. That's my song. And he said, you mentioned us. I was like, yeah, because that was the song of the moment.
It's brilliant. Yeah. It's one of my favorites.
And he said, you know, yeah, that's us. And he said, who are you going to be working with? And we're like, well, you know, we're having some meetings with different people. And, you know, because we were hoping that we would be able to work with them.
The stuff that we listened to. Sometimes we felt we were the only ones that knew how great these people were, because nobody else around us, besides those that are in the know, knew about these artists. Mm-hmm. But I guess it's a case of, in their world, they were probably on the same level as us, as we were in the UK, in terms of being, probably a newly signed artist and haven't really sold that many records.
They were,
as far as I'm concerned, that's arena material, right? And that's what we grew up on.
It's like Cool Keith and that. To us, they were like
Ultra
Magnetic MCs. They were everything for us. Yeah. We were like, everything to us was Ultra. And when we went, nobody was really playing it like we wanted them to. You know, it was other people who were being, but obviously they were the Run DMCs, whatever. So for us, those kinds of groups were what we listened to. Mm. So we went, you know, these guys, they said, you know, we're the kings of pressure. And we were like, well, we're having meetings, you know, for who we're going to be working with. And we don't really. When we went to America, it was hard for us to say, we didn't have any preference of who we wanted to work with when they said, because to
quality and standards
for us, being in America and being put with American artists was like, well, you could put me on anybody. I know it's going to be good.
Is this Kid Vanilla Ice?
Yeah, that's
it.
So yes, Daddy-O was brought to our attention as a producer.
We were
big Stetsasonic fans, and they said, you know Daddy-O from Stetsasonic, he produces, and you know, we're going to get him in to see if he'll work with you on your album.
Because it was DBC as well from Stetsasonic, and they were managed by Rush for a while, and for a short period we were kind of like managed by Rush.
I know it was huge at the time as well, wasn't it? Obviously, I think around the same time Talking About Jazz came out, but before that they did all the, you know, Just Say Stet and everything.
Yeah. So that's where we started having the meetings with Stetsonic, and then we linked with Davey D. Mm-hmm. Black Sheep, that's all on the first album, or was that the second album?
I can't remember. They were a bit later, weren't they?
Was it later? Later.
So the first album was Daddy-O, Stetsasonic.
Yeah. And UK producer that worked with, like, Danny D.
Yeah.
What was that second album? I'll tell you what, can tell me. It's a blur, man.
Yeah, Premier on the second album, wasn't it?
Yeah.
But yeah, so Daddy-O was just an amazing person, a lovely person. The whole of Stetsasonic were just great people.
Mm.
And seeing, you know, the whole sort of Wu-Tang connection with
Prince Paul.
Yeah, and, you know, the other groups, the Grave
Diggers. And seeing them,
look at them and just think, oh my God. Because those days, I don't think we were rapping then. We weren't rapping those days. We'd finished. I was looking at those groups and I was thinking, wow, we used to be in the studio, in Calliope Studio in Manhattan with them.
We even experienced Chung King as well. I mean, those were like,
the studios that we'd heard about, we were in.
That rappers were recording their albums in.
We were in these studios recording our album. We were like, whoa. So, working with Stetsasonic was amazing because they were just brilliant people, really nice people. And we'd heard, you know, that...
And they wanted to work with us, so that made it... We never felt a case of, oh, okay, we're English girls from London and they're signed to a label and we're getting paid to do this job. We didn't feel that. We felt it's like we hung out prior to, and you know, we'd go to Daddy-O's house. I think he had a studio house, so we'd go and kind of like work on stuff there, met his family. It was a bit more of a organic, very genuine setup.
Sure.
We didn't stick a studio there writing a song, or you're writing a song and they're producing it on your phone.
And you know what was different as well is that we Debbie's sister lives in New York. She lived in New York since the 70s, her older sister. So when we went to record in America, we lived in the Bronx. Mm. And we'd get on the bus and go down to Manhattan.
Is that modern times?
It was better. Yeah. And we felt better doing that because then we felt like we were more part of what
Hip-hop
was happening.
Hip-hop is early. It was all around us.
But that also shows you we knew nothing about the whole corporate side of things. Because really, nowadays, you go and record something, you've got to get a cab home. Mm. By law, you get a cab home. Of course, it's all recoupable.
Yeah.
Everything you spend is recoupable. So
we'd get the bus and get on the subway.
But we loved it. And my sister used to go, girls, what time you come in? And just, we're like, yeah, but we're going to...
New York was a bit more of a dangerous place back then, wasn't it?
Yeah.
It's not like it is now.
We used to ride that subway back to the Bronx. And we used to, what we used to do is find the coach that had the policeman on it.
Yeah.
Because he'd always be on one.
Or the Guardian Angels.
So the police officer would always look out down and he'd see who was getting on and then he'd go back in. If he went into a different carriage, we'd follow him where he's going.
Right.
We're going to see him.
So you were aware of the dangers at the time, yeah.
But we didn't let us deter us.
Because everybody would tell us, you know, we're in a studio and we're leaving there like late midnight and stuff and they're going, you're riding the subway back to the Bronx. We're like,
And you have to go through the South.
So we were happy to do that.
And then we'll get to a certain point, because we're staying and living in Soundview at the point, and we'll get off at that station and just jump in a gypsy taxi that will take you,
your dollar ride.
But it's all exciting, it's all part of the experience, you know?
Yeah. So we lived in New York for a year, didn't we? And for recording and everything that we did. We stayed in the Bronx.
Mm. And things were evolving in the UK while I was away.
That's what I was going to ask.
Radio stations been set up. There's a show called Dance Energy that's on. Just things were happening, you know?
So the fact that, I mean, you were in the US, well, I'm assuming around 88, right?
Yes.
The sort of time you were there. Obviously, there was an awful lot of UK stuff that was coming out around the same time with the Musical Life label and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
How did that go down with...
The US?
When we came back, we were not received well by our British scene. Whereas we just came back and thought we just slipped back into normality. Mm. They were like, we sold out, we recorded America, we recorded American artists had made our album and all this, and we were like, what? And it was like that for a long time.
We stood strong.
We were ostracized, but we stood our ground on a lot. We had to. Mm. It was just me and her. Mm. And then, you know, and other people who, you know, there were people around us who supported us or who tried to help us, like Billy, you know, different DJs who were like, you know, no, Cooks, you know, just, you know, stay on your ground.
And people that were slightly against us, and it took a while, but surely, they came back. They came around.
And in the end, they worked in America for years.
Yeah. I think there must have been a bit of jealousy.
But when you think back, that's only natural. Do you know what I mean? And I think it's all part of the process and all part of the growing experience of it all. And I think it got so bad in London particularly, the reception we were getting from people, and
we stopped going out,
and we refused to do shows in London at what point. We got to a point where we refused to do shows, and then we were obviously making records, things on the charts, and we had to do a show in London. Remember that day? I don't know what we were allowed to say.
Stetsasonic.
It was a show. It was at Town and Country Club. I can't remember who else was on the bill. It might have been a corporate event in some capacity. Mm. But remember, you was ill. We're so nervous. It was such a, because we'd come back from America, we were doing stuff, it's like, oh my God, we got to do a show, because we're doing shows in Europe, in London, out London, but we had to do a show in London, and we couldn't not do it.
Yeah, I was so ill.
We had to have, paramedics were at the side of the stage, were ordered to be at the side of the stage, were brought in.
Yeah, I was sick.
Because I was nervous.
I just couldn't, I thought I'd pass out at one point upstairs in this
room. But once again, we went up there and killed it.
Yeah.
But let's face it, I mean, that first album was brilliant.
It was
so good.
It wasn't just that, it was a commercial success as well, wasn't it?
But for being hardcore hip hop to be a commercial success.
And
I mean,
you know, we worked with US artists and we worked with UK artists. We worked with Dazzle, who was our DJ. We worked with, did Danny do the first or the second timeline? No, Danny was on the second album, wasn't he? Who worked? Yeah, sometimes it was mostly like a lot of Dazzle stuff, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Dazzle and the US, because we brought Dazzle over to the US with us to work alongside Daddy-O and all the producers we're working with. So he built a nice relationship with them, and it was great to have him as our support, you know, being a producer, but also when we went out live, he was our DJ, you know, and he was tight as hell, man. Our shows, we had so much fun. We had a lot of fun. Definitely on the road, we had so much fun. And from there, so yeah, suppose
on the flip side, how well did it go down in the US, obviously you being UK MCs.
It was
MCs.
Lovely. You know what, people, I think we were doubting ourselves.
You had a fair pedigree behind you. So. Yeah.
I suppose we weren't too sure because we was in New York, but we still kept our little London thing going on, you know. We'd go out to clubs, but it was like...
Well, I seen the Born This Way video with the...
Yeah,
the policeman.
Fat
Five
Freddy.
Fat
Five
Freddy,
And what's his name?
MC Search.
Third base.
It took us a while to build that confidence of sort of like, you know, we're British and we're in New York and we're here when we're on your turf. But I think as we started meeting people, we realised, oh, actually, they do like us, you know, and they actually see us as being good. And we were building up a little reputation. There's a few times we used to walk around New York and people used to recognise, and that was in the early days because our videos were shown on MTV Raps, you know what I mean? And
Rap City.
Yeah, so I just think it just built, and then we started meeting people, and then, you know, as a city reputation just kind of grows. And then we started working with, you know, second album, we were working with the likes of Black Sheep and working with Gangstar, and, you know, it just kind of enlightened what we were about and how serious we were. And, you know.
And how long after the first album was the second album? It was about a couple of years, was it?
Probably, yeah.
Yeah.
It was about, was it 91?
91.
And obviously hip-hop had changed then.
Oh, but
the albums are different sound.
And they're totally different. Yeah. Obviously you had collaborations with all sorts of people, didn't you? So.
It was different, it was very different. And that was when I think doing the albums was, I didn't realise, through being naive, that somebody else could write a rap for you. I just didn't think that was
acceptable.
You can't write a rap for me. That I'm, you know, I've got to, you know. And it was when Guru wrote for us, and I just thought,
all right then.
That was fine, but
really? And I said, I remember saying to them, like, but what will people think? They said, people do that all the time out here. We're like, really? He said, yes. He said, it's nothing. We're like, oh, okay. Yeah. So Guru was like, okay, I'm going to quickly write. So, like, that took him like a couple of seconds.
And because with Guru
there
as well.
You go.
Because with those guys, when we met them, it wasn't like, we've got some girls from London, we're going to go to the studio, record this 24 hours, we get paid, they can pee off. Yeah. We actually hung out and spent time with them, so they got to know us as individuals.
Yeah.
So when he wrote our song, A Word to the Conscious, he wrote
and
for
us. And that's
the
one that Premier produced.
So that
and
was
he
fine.
Wrote through like conversations we'd had about different things, and you
like
hear
he listened.
It's a cool track.
He listened.
And it was just great. And they'd come up to the Bronx to Debbie's sisters, like some of them, not all of them. They'd come pick us up with what's his name from Nice and Smooth.
Greg Nice
used to hang with them a lot, and so we all used to like go different places together, and we were just so, it was just
felt,
like how we were in London,
we felt comfortable,
one of the boys, we weren't like the girls who were tagging along, we were one of the boys.
So they'll and take us out to clubs, we'll go to eat, you know, then we'll tour. So when it came time to go in the studio, there was like a mutual respect, and they knew what we want. And Black Sheep wrote a song for us as well. Was it Drez that wrote the song for us? Yeah, the first song he wrote for us, and I remember it was, I think he wrote before Guru wrote for us.
Yeah.
And
he hadn't really met us properly.
No. And they had just signed.
They were fairly new.
But they wanted, the labels wanted to place us together because they were new and there was a buzz about them and they were going to explode, so let's connect early. So the first song that he wrote for us, remember, it was hilarious. He wrote some lyrics for us.
We didn't understand.
We used to rehearse in my sister's apartment because
we didn't understand. I remember I said to him,
I throw the paper and I go, Susan, I don't know what I'm chatting about. Because there were
I don't know what I'm saying. Yeah. I don't know what this is.
Because there were words relating to your caboose, which is your, you know, things that we weren't. I think it were too girly for us.
Yeah,
we plucked up the courage. We're like, how are we going
to
do this?
We had to say
we tell
them
we don't like it. But it was fine. We went and we told them.
They were fine. They laughed about it. They were like, oh yeah, fine. Because I said to him, and then I said, what's dial? And he said, soap.
Yeah,
I was like,
what's caboose?
Really? I just can't. And he said, but we're the writers. So we're like, okay. But I said, you've got to do something that we understand.
Yeah.
We don't understand this stuff.
I think after the conversation,
they thought we were from out of space. Because we were just like, I just don't get it.
And then it went away, came back with Going Freestyle.
Yeah.
And that was completely us.
Yeah.
You know, and that we
absolutely.
Bought. And on that track, we brought in Terry, and her rapping name was Desire. She was like a homegirl from the Bronx. Yeah. And we met her.
Just the girl from the Bronx.
Yeah. Literally. Like, we really? Met, yeah.
Come
we,
with us. We yeah. met, on our track.
We met her years before. How it was, yeah, because that was the second album we recorded, actually.
Yeah.
We met her years before on our Born This Way video shoot.
Yeah.
She was part of the crowd scene yeah. in the house. Mm. And when we
She said she was from the Bronx. We're yeah. like, we're living in the Bronx. Where are you?
So we took each other's number, and then 2 years later when we came back to record the second album, we're sitting in the Bronx in a park, so we ain't got no mates, it's just me and her. And then we rang our management, because they obviously had the list of people that was on the video shoot, blah, blah, blah. And we remembered this girl, Terry, and her cousins and sisters that were there, because we were hanging out with them. So we called, we found the number, we called her, and was like, oh, it's us, we're here. And literally, she lived like a few blocks up the road from where we were staying.
Yeah.
So we kind of connected from that, and then she was spitting on one of the tracks on the album.
Yeah,
excellent. You know, and she's our homegirl to this day.
Yeah.
And we've been through so much together, you know, it's just, we've had so many amazing experiences.
It's like Lisa Lee.
Yeah.
MC Lisa Lee.
I've connected with her.
Still, you know, have contact with MC
really?
Lisa Lee.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, we went to her apartment, she had that wolf.
Yeah, Kato.
Dog called Kato.
Yeah,
we went to the Bronx.
She lived literally about 5 minutes from where my sister lived.
Yeah.
So we went to visit her.
So we made a connection. We went to her house, and I swear she was saying, like, you got to keep it inside because it's a wolf.
It's a wolf,
and
yeah.
And if people see it, they'll know, they'll take it away.
Yeah.
Bloody hell.
Yeah.
We were like, what?
And the dog was called Kato. If I remember, it's called Kato.
Keep the dog, keep it inside because it's a wolf. Yeah. I couldn't believe it. I was like,
gorgeous dog it was. But when you looked at it, it's like,
I know that's going off, right?
Yeah, it's a wolf.
Yeah. But it's just stuff. Yeah. It's just that we've always made sure that we try and keep those connections with people.
Yeah,
and you know, with
those people looked after us.
Yeah.
Those people
totally,
looked
yeah.
to
yeah.
us.
They were
and
inspiration.
They helped us when times when we were feeling like we were nothing in England and people hated us. Those were the people who were saying to us, you know, don't listen. You just got to continue, and you just got to, you know. And that it was like that, and we had a group of people, and I say that Billy was definitely one of them, who would also say to us, you know, you cooks, you just got to not listen to this stuff, and you've got to come out, because we would like become a recluse, you know.
We got to a point
like,
where
you wouldn't go out, and it's like, you've got to come out, because people are just thinking that you're not around anymore, that you've got
can
to
I ask
out.
Who was saying stuff
and, I think it was generally everybody, and
it
a lot of people
that you're thinking.
No, I'm not thinking anything.
You know what? It was a bunch of people in the scene,
it
and it was fine because you know what? When years later, and even when you bump into people nowadays, it's like that rival we had back
we
in the day.
We met someone the other day. I swear this is a true story. We met someone the other day. I'm not going to say who. I'm not going to mention. Met someone the other day. I saw this guy from across the street. We were down Clapham Junction, me and her, and he looked at us and he said, "Cookie Crew." And I was like, I know this dude's face, but I don't know from. And he came over, and you know what he said? He said, "I want to apologise for how I was
for
back
my
in
behaviour."
The day.
Really?
Yeah.
And I was like,
Did you tell us who it was after this?
No.
Is not filming.
I said, probably somebody they won't even know anyway.
Yeah,
but
and I said,
name,
and
but,
I said,
you know
what? I said that means a lot to me because I said we went through a lot of shit, and for you to come and say that. Take the time to come and say that to me. That's important.
And they explained the reasoning why they had.
Yeah, it was nice. I was like, that's
attitude
cool.
at the time.
It's cool. It's cool.
But,
it's all.
But like I said, I think it was all that whole rival. It's all looking back. It was healthy competition. There
who
was
were
guns
the, who were the main rivals
for us?
For females.
Yeah.
It was. I suppose it was us and She Rockers. Yeah. But the scene they fueled that.
Yeah, of course.
You know, they fueled it, and I suppose no matter what, we'd go in and write our best lyrics, go on stage and kill it. They go and do their best lyrics and go on stage and kill it. But it is what it is. But Cookie Crew reigns supreme. It was harmless. And it was fantastic. It's like, you know what? Last year, was it the year before?
I think we'll be getting the She-Rockers in here.
No. You know what? Last year, the year before, I was on a panel with Donna. We was on this.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it was...
It's all good.
It's all great. Mm. Right? We was on this panel, Inspirational You panel. Fantastic setup. Check them out. Inspirational You online now. No, they do great panels and stuff, you know, about the industry, different covering all subjects. And she was on a panel. It was me, her, a few other entities. And it was like, and after we were speaking, it was like, and we told the crowd, we told the audience who we were. Obviously, they knew who we were, but they didn't know about our history.
Yeah.
And it was like, we haven't spoken for 25 years. Mm. How funny is that? Because we'd never had anything to talk about because it was rivalry, but it was about hip hop.
Yeah.
Sure.
What do you think about
it? It was never about anything
else. Nothing personal.
It was nothing personal.
Yeah.
There was no guys involved. There was no nothing. It was nothing about me. It was nothing.
It was territory.
Because they kind of echoed a little bit of what you guys did. They had Professor Griff, I think, produce some of their bits, didn't they? And stuff like that.
It was strictly about hip hop. And that's what I think. That's what's good about it. Yeah. We need to appreciate about the rivalry between us and She Rockers. It was hip hop.
Yeah.
It wasn't about anything else. It was about rhyming. It was about producers.
Even how you dressed.
How you dressed. It was about getting on the stage and who gave the best show. That's what it was about. It was never about anything else. And that's what was good about it.
Mm.
Because that's what made us better.
Yeah.
Want to be better.
Yeah.
Want to
but at the time, things, obviously, you know, that was like serious things, but it never got to any kind of, when you think about things that happen now within the industry and all kind of genres, violence, this, that and the other, and people getting killed because their album's better, it's like it wasn't about that. It was all about just about territory and killing it in a jam.
Yeah.
How harmful is that to
everyone? No, of course.
Yeah.
I mean, so it's all good.
But everybody obviously knew about it, and you know, it was one of those things that.
Because I'm trying to, what about some of the others at the time? I know that the Wee Papa Girl rappers, sort of, they went very commercial, didn't they?
That was completely different. And then you had
Kiss AMC up north as well, didn't you?
Kiss AMC?
Yeah. They were with the Ruthless Rap Assassins. And
right, okay, I remember that. I remember the name. I just can't put any faces, and I can't remember if we had any rival with anybody out town.
No.
I don't think we did.
Moni Love.
Oh, no, I think it was always neutral with Moni. And Moni got out of the UK at a very early...
Yeah.
You know, we all
wasn't it around the same sort of time as you guys, though?
She went after
us. She went slightly after.
And what was good about her is that
She didn't give a fuck.
I remember saying to her before she went, and I said, you know, are you worried about this whole going to America and staying out? She's like, what?
It's about her business.
She's like, I don't give a fuck. I do not care about that.
No.
You got to go and do what you've got to do, and that's what I'm going to do. And I was like, why didn't we say that? We went through this whole kind of... She was like, no.
We just wanted to please the UK.
Whereas she pretty much became an American.
Yeah.
There you go.
You know?
The thing about us in America, we were always very British. And we couldn't get away from that. We just couldn't. You know, we try, sometimes they say, you know, oh, you're rapping, you've got a bit of American accent. But, you know, if you're trying to rap what Drez is writing with a Cockney accent, it ain't going to work.
Mm.
So we were kind of like, oh, mate, it's got to be, you've got to try and put the
and
thing
it,
in here.
It was hard, it was difficult.
But we were the start of it. So somebody had to start it somewhere, and somebody had to have a go, and then someone had to realize, because obviously, you know, when London Posse came with their vibe, we were like, yeah, that's how it's supposed to be, you know.
But you got to be able to carry it off. I don't think we could have carried it off.
I think we could have
with a real full-on British Cockney thing, and it wasn't. With London Posse, that was their style.
Yeah,
you know, that was
which
their
I think the Americans really appreciated that.
Absolutely.
You know,
that's what happened. I mean, they made it. I think, you know, they just made it happen right at the right time in the right way. And whereas, you know, we weren't doing that, and that was they were amazing.
I suppose we just done what's comfortable to us. And remember, from growing up, all of
us were just so early. You know,
Well, I suppose all of you early influences were American, weren't they?
Exactly.
You know, I mean,
exactly.
Millie Jackson on stage, you know what I mean? Yeah.
Exactly. We had nobody
not just
else.
The hip-hop stuff, that
exactly,
the stuff
yeah.
prior to that, you know, that's what we were raised on. And it was, and regardless, people still knew that we weren't, the Americans knew that we weren't American, do you know what I mean? It wasn't like, why are you talking
said,
American
said, your rapping voice sounds really English. We're like, really? People think we sound really American.
Oh, no,
we don't care.
Yeah.
Whatever.
So what happened then after the second album?
Second album was done... we've done it, we toured it,
and I just think the record company wanted us to go
more commercial.
Right.
Yeah, and I just
this
think
is where the problem started after the second album.
They were happy with the second album, everybody was happy, but it's like going forward it would have been a struggle,
didn't make the money that they wanted it to make, and they felt that we needed to go more commercial. We felt we couldn't do that.
Yeah.
We felt that we'd gone as commercial as we could. And that we thought we were being really commercial, like too commercial. So we were like, but we're trying to be more, we want to go the other way now. We want to go harder than this now. We felt like we'd given you what, and they were like, no, it's not, we need it to be, we need chart success. We said, we're just not going to get that.
And I think
suppose hip hop was going in that direction.
It was
then,
changing.
Wasn't it?
We're not going to get that.
I think they probably hoped that we'd have flipped the script a bit, but And it was when our contract ended, it was like a mutual thing. It was it was an organic ending, like the contract came to an end.
Wasn't our last thing on tour with De La Soul? Wasn't that the last?
De La Soul was earlier than that.
Really?
Yeah. I think we recorded, and then even after our contract ended, we were still on this other contract, because they still wanted us to record, because I think they still wanted to kind of, you know, retrieve something or whatever. But, you know, we had it. It was
we started to do as many sort of hardcore raps that we wanted to do with as many people as we could.
We were
on the British scene.
We were collaborating with people.
So we started
and doing
collaborating
shows, you know what I mean?
With people. We did Rap to Your Face and Diss You.
Yeah,
we
with
did
D2, Dion.
We did that.
Where was Dion?
And we did that. And we tried to just get on other people's stuff who were doing, British rappers who were doing stuff, who wanted us on.
Yeah.
We'd get on their stuff and try and do as much, you know, hardcore. We did that one. There was a lot of cussing in that one that Tim Westwood played that time. And, you know,
what, right, the one,
was that Rap to Your Face and Diss You? That one.
What was that
Mental
one
Maniac was a little bit like...
No, Mental Maniac wasn't cussing. I think it was just fast. Going on, while we performed that, boys, it was mental. Yeah, so I suppose that album done its thing. I mean, we've done the usual touring interviews, blah, blah, blah. But I think while we were during that album, I think that's the point when we were talking to media. God, did we call it media back then? When we were talking to press producers, I think we were slowly and subliminally saying, you know, one day we're going to sort of like put the microphone down.
Because
we were getting people ready.
Yeah, because we didn't want to... One, we didn't want to compromise ourselves with what they wanted us to do. And every label... Say London Records, FFR, didn't want us anymore because we weren't going to do what they wanted us to do. Other labels that expressed interest in us also wanted the same kind of thing. They didn't.
We had offers
they
from
didn't want us
Europe
to do
stuff. We're like,
but we just didn't
want to go through that again.
We unless we could do exactly what we wanted to do.
Did you think about putting anything out yourselves?
That kind of stuff wasn't on our radar at the time.
No,
I suppose it was a funny time as well. Like it was the end of a certain era, wasn't it? In the early 90s, where hip hop really changed.
Exactly.
And a lot of people that were into hip hop were actually now starting to get into things like acid jazz and stuff like that.
We lost a lot of people.
We lost a lot of
people
through that.
And a lot, I think, there were the wilderness years for UK hip hop, especially.
It's
was
like,
the
way they migrated over. It's like when the announcement at the end of disco in America.
Yeah.
It's like people just like. It's like, but the core people stuck with it.
Yeah.
Because you know what was, I know this is going to sound really strange, but you know what actually killed it for us as well. As we come to that second, as we started to make that second, when breaking stopped.
Yeah. It went back underground.
And nobody was breaking anymore.
Yeah.
And for us, a hip hop jam was the breakers.
Even if it weren't the B-boys.
Graffiti artists.
It was certainly the dancers.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You had people doing the Bismarcky and the WAP, you know what I mean?
Somebody doing a piece behind you while you're rapping, a graffiti piece. You got the breakers, that was all gone.
Well, the breakers went into the acid jazz scene and the funk scene, didn't they?
Yeah.
Big time.
Yeah.
And that really depressed us. There were breakers who still hung on, you know, and today, like.
Well, they all came back out in 1996 when the Break B-Boy Championships came out again. I was there, I was like, excellent, it's coming back, fantastic.
That is, you know,
chuck away me acid jazz records.
Yeah. No, you went there. Oh, man, how did you do that? So that made it a bit and more dancing hip hop came in.
It got really that commercial thing started to, and there was an element of that dance sound that kind of infiltrated and
we got into that a bit. We had some of our, you know, guys who were breakers would start to do the hip hop dances and stuff and that, but it really was changing. It was like a different face of hip hop,
and I think we tried to salvage it within our own little world where us and a group of other friends, we wanted to put on gigs, like hip-hop shows and shows that were specifically female artists, whether you're a dancer, singer, rapper. And, you know, we just got into this thing like, let's put on gigs. And it was a case of going to a venue, whatever, negotiate a deal, and you pay them when the door money comes, as opposed to putting down a deposit and paying for a venue up front. So we've done shows, we've done a show at the Marquee, I think we've done a couple of shows at the Marquee, and we literally booked that ourselves, we promoted ourselves, we had posters made out, we had a posters printed out, we had a bucket full of wallpaper paste, we'd jump in our cars late in the night and drive all around London.
That was
literally
the all-female rappers show.
Yeah, we'd done a show
called...
about 10 female rappers on that show.
Yeah, it was a show called Sister to Sister.
Right.
And it was at the Marquee, can't remember what year it was. It might have been 90...
And I had a tape which I've lost.
Oh my god, a videotape.
Yeah, I had a tape of the show. I can't find it. And that is like, to me,
I remember
that is our best performance.
Do you remember
ever?
Do you remember
ever.
That move?
Yeah. That is our best performance.
Shocked ourselves.
Ever. Yeah. Ever.
It was impromptu.
Rap, freestyle. Right. Billy was DJing, wasn't he?
Yeah, it was Billy. No, it wasn't. Wasn't Dean DJing for that night?
Did he DJ that night?
Well, maybe he did. I can't remember.
Anyway, it was
he'll
great.
Remember when we ask him. Because Billy, every time we forget something about hip hop, we send Billy a note.
Yeah, we sent him a text last night to ask him about the name of a track. Yeah. ESG track that we couldn't remember. Punk Beat. We used to call it Punk Beat, but he knew the right name of it, and it was ESG, but I can't remember the first name of the thing, but it was that punk. Well, you call it Punk Beat, but it was a beat that breakers used to break to.
Well, it was UFO
at the time. UFO by ESG. So I texted him last night because I said, what was Punk Beat called again?
And he was calling tracks.
Yeah. We were like, what's that one? Commodore's Video Man?
Yeah.
It's Assembly Line.
Yeah, we were laughing at that because we used to call it that because that's what we thought you were saying. So yeah, we used to
love that.
It's great.
It was our time, I think. To go.
And we wasn't into cursing on our raps because it wasn't kind of hip hop that we were raised on anyway.
It didn't need to be done.
Yeah, it wasn't part of DNA. It wasn't need to be done. But the last one, we said we're going to cuss on this. So we done a record.
You blooming rotters.
Yeah. Bloody whatever.
Bankers.
Yeah. Did we do it with D2?
Yeah, but who was it? No, we did. You know, the male rappers on it. Huckleberry Finn.
Huckleberry Finn.
He was on it.
Yeah, what was that track we done with them?
Yeah.
And DT was on it, they were on it.
Yeah.
What's the label that they was on? Because it went through that label.
What, Hun Kilberry Finn?
Yeah.
At what time? Sorry.
He was part of a clique before that, wasn't he?
Yeah, he was part of the... He was sort of involved with Hijack on that Burial Proceedings, and then he was...
What the other guy? I can see everybody's faces, but the names are gone.
That was a fantastic
track.
Remember Ice Pick? Yeah. That was a fantastic
track. We done a collaboration, and we went to a studio somewhere down... Sort of like,
we did as much cussing as we could on that.
Yeah,
track.
We got it out of the system.
Got it out of the system.
And performed it live.
Yeah, and we said,
oh my god,
it.
That one was cussing about like girls wearing lichen and weave and everything. Like, we went in.
It's years of abuse, pent up abuse.
It was pressed up, yeah.
What
was that song called?
Let It All Out, I can't remember. Somebody out there will know.
Yeah.
Can't remember.
I'll call it.
Hi, Andrew.
But the very last thing, we were asked by... just as kind of like, I don't know, reflect on your life. We were asked by the British Council to go to Uganda and Kenya to work with children who have HIV and AIDS
and
how to express themselves through rap and rhyme.
Brilliant.
And we were asked to do that and we thought, yeah, that'd be so cool. Yeah, we'll do that. And he said, you're going to go to different villages and do different things. So we said, right, we're going to ask Billy to come with us, Big Ted. And we need some dancers and stuff.
Yeah, we had two dancers that came with us, Sabrina. These are just senile moments, but the names. Anyway, we had these two dancers with us who we had met on one of the shows that we had put on because we had booked them to do the all-female show. So they were like the dancers for the night. Then we took them to Uganda with us as well. Lady Banfield here. She can't remember them. We spent 3 weeks on the road in Uganda with two dancers on every show that we performed.
If you're seeing this dancer one, dancer two, stop crying into your pillow.
I don't know why. Certain things, I don't know.
Some things just get blocked out, doesn't it?
I don't know, but...
Do you go into the wrong house sometimes?
Sit down, make a cup of tea.
Yeah, so we've done that trip.
We
took Billy for the first 2 weeks because he had to come back.
He had to do a gig with somebody else. I don't know if it was Pogo or somebody he had to come back for.
And then
he did 2 weeks with us and then he went back and Ted came out. Ted came out. And it was on that trip that we were working these villages and working with these children. And they were telling us their stories about parents dying and having no family through AIDS. And we're meeting all these people. And we were sitting in a village, just finished doing a gig, because what we do is we do a workshop. So Billy and Ted would run like a DJ workshop. We would do like the history of hip hop in England, how it started, where it came from in America, and we took all of our album covers, so we decorate the hall with all the album covers of all hip hop groups.
We bought writing pads and pencils because they had nothing,
everything,
literally.
and we got them writing raps, and at the end of every workshop they would put on the show. and we would like watch and help them and whatever, and it was fantastic. And it was sitting in one of those villages that I turned to Debbie and I said, I don't want to do this anymore. And she said, neither do I. And I said, we've got to do something that's more meaningful, because these people are going through things that
we came back with a different view of life.
You know, what are we doing? You know, we're trying to get another record deal. We'll make it. And I just said, I just don't want to do that. And she said exactly the same as I said it. She said it. You know, it's like you have those points in your life, and it's like where Afrika Bambaataa and Red Alert and that stopped us and schooled us and told us what to do, changed everything in our life, changed everything in our head, what we were doing. This was another moment where it did the same thing. It was like, what are you doing?
And this, it was 3 weeks, you know, solid.
You just, it changed everything.
Completely on the road, and there was no flying in between. It was, so you saw everything. You went through certain borders, you saw the poverty. And when we went anywhere, it's like, people running after the bus, and kids would be standing outside a hotel waiting for us to come, and we'd go and talk to everyone. We didn't know anything about not communicating with people that we've come to see. And they say, you know, Michael Jackson came here and he didn't come out and say hello to us. And you come and say hello to us. And like, how difficult is that? And then we'll be, one time we're sitting in the foyer and it was World AIDS Day. So there was different conferences going on, blah, blah, blah. And then some people came up to us and goes, oh, they thought we were the Sheikh's daughters. They thought we were Sheikh's daughters.
We nearly said, yeah.
But you know, it was an experience. I think coming back from that trip, it was one of the best trips of my life. I can honestly say, because we came back and
that's what made us stop.
Yeah,
to kind of
like we kind of like started to wind down, thinking we have to make records after this. It's like there are other things to do in life. With me, I'm still in the industry in a different capacity because I've stepped over into different elements and different realms of what the industry is. But yeah, sometimes you just need somebody to tell you, you know what, there's something more important than what you think is important. And hip-hop is one of the most important things in the world because it encompasses everything. Everything. Some people don't understand that, and it means a lot. And
too many people think of hip-hop as just rap.
Sound a bit stupid, but
they forget about graffiti, forget about breaking,
they forget the source.
Everything. Absolutely. Foundation. What's Pete always talking about, Pete from Live to Break? Foundation. Forget about the foundation.
It's a lot of things. A lot of things is hip hop, but it's not necessarily has to be you rapping or DJing. It could be you've done something that's wrong. That's not very hip hop. That's not a hip hop thing to do. So it has, to me, to us, it's always had a deeper meaning. Sometimes I don't think people understand that, and I think we're a bit
mad,
stupid. But
so how have you, I mean, obviously with what you do now in regards to your job, have you sort of stayed in contact with hip hop, if you like?
Obviously,
you know, you stopped the, I mean, I realise obviously you've gone into a different field altogether, which sounds like possibly on the basis
of
going to Africa. You know?
She was actually studying all of that while we were recording and touring and doing stuff. She was studying on the plane and that, because, you know, no matter what, we always knew that in some years' time you're going to want to do something different. Whatever your forte is and your passion is, you're going to fulfil it. You know, you're not going to sit and wait for hip hop to save your life or for, you know, do you know what I mean?
Do your kids at school know what about your past life?
Are they gonna?
I think
the mums and dads.
I think they do. I did get a bit of that from mums and dads, but I've had that before from mums and dads. And I had someone sent in a tape of my album. A tape. I haven't seen a tape for how long?
Well, I've still got some of those. Look, there's loads down there.
Of Born This Way album, and I asked me to sign it.
I remember when CDs first came. I remember when we first got a CD copy of one of our tracks. Like, what the hell is
just
this?
Just how old we are, I think we've, in terms of the connection with, I don't have as much of the connection as Deb does.
Yeah.
Because she's still in that interest. I don't have that connection. But
in a sense, I think connection meaning, forget the work side of it. I think connection, like, we don't have to go out to clubs to understand. We still have this crazy hip-hop thing that we do off record, off air, in our own space, where we will be playing music and dancing.
We put music on at the time when we dance. But we have our life. Is hip hop. We can't
change it. You can't change it, no matter what your career is.
We've not ever, I can honestly say that Debbie and I listen to a lot of different kinds of music. but we're always hip-hop.
That is hip-hop, because
everything we get is from, you know, you hear that break. you hear that break. You know, everything we do is connected to that, you know what I mean? So it's just...
Well, yeah, we're still... It's not that I, you know, I'm not going to say I rush out and buy records or downloads and that, but I still know when something comes on my radar. At the moment, the album that I'm listening to, I class it as hip-hop because it's so friggin' hot, is Rudimental album, Home. Every single track on that is so creative.
The elements are...
It's like, this is how a body of work should sound. Mm. But to me, that's hip-hop.
Mm. But the days of hip-hop, people like Kool G Rap and Polo, and those kinds of days of our era, we still live in that at home.
I still live in this shed.
We play music, like up to last night we were playing, that's why I started sending them emails to you.
Cool.
Oh, what about trends of culture? What about, you know, just things that we are passionate about. And when you play those, and you listen to the production and simplicity of it, the lyrical content, the delivery, it's far superior from what I'm hearing now.
Don't forget, it also takes you back to a time when you first heard it, and sometimes
when everything was good, when life was good, you know, and it was a fantastic time.
I mean, we went out not long ago. Well, I know you go out more than me,
but I don't. That's the impression she gets.
She does.
Hobnobbing with your clients.
We went to see Mos Def and Tyler
and Rakim and De La Soul,
and because Rakim was there,
yes, he was,
which was great. And we came to Hammersmith where it was, and we started walking round to the back door because Billy told us that our name was on at the back door, which it wasn't, Billy. But Billy sorted us out in the end. But anyway, business told us go round to the side. So we're walking, and as we're walking through, I can hear people saying, "Is that them? That can't be them. That can't be them.
Brilliant.
That can't be them." Like, I don't know if I don't know if it's, I don't know what it is, but they were just like, I could hear them saying that. Anyway, got round the corner. As we turned the corner, we saw De La Soul standing outside in the road, and they were like, and he's like, "What are you doing here?"
They shouted us out on the mic that night.
Oh, nice.
We were just like, got round the corner, like, "What are you doing?" I said, I don't go out. I've not been out for over 20 years. I don't go anywhere unless, you know. And then we went to see Premier, because Premier came over and did a gig in London.
Yeah.
Didn't he do the Spin Doctor?
He did.
Yeah, Spin Doctor.
Is that what we went?
Hybrid Incident. What's that venue
called? The garage. The garage.
Yeah, we were there.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
So he was texting?
No, it was on Tweet.
Yeah, and he was going, "I'm going on, we're in the club." And he's like, "Yeah, I'm going on now." And then he comes on stage and does his thing up. And, you know, we listened to him DJ and everything. And that's like the only second time that I've been
out. No, honestly, two times.
That's because they've told us that they're doing that, so we've gone.
Yeah.
But otherwise, I don't go anywhere.
It's just not the same vibe. I mean, if I do go anywhere and I see the energy of what young people are listening to now, the whole, you know, what's going on in the Afrobeat scene, what's going on with the UK artists, that's fucking fantastic.
Mm.
I know what they're feeling.
Mm.
I'm not a part of
that. Not going to get it, but...
Yeah, exactly, because that's their way.
That's you understand.
That's their moment.
You understand it.
When I watch them, you went through it. You see them performing, you see their fans reciting their lyrics, you see the dance routines that people are doing, or the dance rates. It's like... That was us 15, 20 years ago. I know that feeling. Mm. Just I can't get down like that anymore.
Mm. 25 you know? Years
yeah.
ago. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I can't. Like, when we used to go to a club, boy, as soon as we was that dance floor, it's like all our knees were here, the thighs. Because you dance all friggin' night.
Yeah. Yeah.
Every single track was good. Mm-hmm. When an artist came to do a show, the show was good.
Mm.
Every artist, it got to a point where every artist that came to the US, we was supporting on the bill. And then we supported Bobby Brown at Wembley for like 8-9 nights. And how we got that, I remember we was on tour, must have been touring the second album. And
yeah, we went to some mad places. Keithley and Cohen, I didn't understand those places.
I think we had to Ripley. Run. We went to Ripley.
We were on a tour bus in those places and they said, "We're sending your album to..."
We're sending a video and submitting our stuff to... his team, because they're going to choose who's going to be support act in the UK. Mm.
They're choosing out of like 5-6 people. Yeah. And then we got the call that
one day.
Got,
how big was the phone on the tour bus?
Mobile phone.
Mobile phone. Like, we got the.
You got Wembley. Bobby Brown. They're like, wow.
We can start inviting our parents out for gigs now. Yeah.
Our parents couldn't go to anything before.
We supported Guy, De La Soul, Public Enemy, EPMD. Mm. And then, you know, when the UK acts were, you know, torn up and down the country, it's nice being on a bill with you. It was just, the atmosphere was incredible. Mm. That's got to be the highest high.
Do you miss it?
I miss it. I do miss it in a sense that, not like, gosh, I wish it was happening now. I miss it because...
You miss the feeling you had back then, I suppose, yeah.
Well, we got a lot of producers that watch this show, so you want to put a track in?
Yeah, send me some beats, yeah.
Me and Brad can make you some beats. Yeah. Some beats. No problem.
Some beans.
Yeah. Beans. Yeah. Egg on that, yeah.
Yeah. Debbie, I can honestly say, since we finished Cookie Crew, Debbie and I have never... not been in contact with each other. We're still the same as what we were before we started.
We can tell.
Yeah.
We're still exactly the same. We've always been like this. Mm. But I've actually forgotten what I was talking about.
Right, basically.
But you don't miss it.
Yeah, she. No, yeah. I don't miss it. Yeah. But she always keeps the whole Cookie Crew thing going as if we're still in the band.
Yeah.
So at home, she's always talking about things like, if we're going out to Sainsbury's, like, yeah, we're going to do a gig. And she talks like that all the time. It drives me
even
mad.
Even coming to this,
yeah, that is a gig I'd like to see in my Sainsbury's.
I'm really pleased that this is a gig. Yeah.
She
Chris got front row seats.
To like stuff, you know. You get a phone call from anything. She's like, "Is it the £50,000 publishing thing that we're getting?" Like, it's just crap. She's making up all the time. So she's always livid on that. It's hilarious. And I always said, "Debbie, stop it."
But I'm glad we see the fun side of it. Nothing's that serious. Certain elements of it are serious because it's. It's just part of what we were raised in.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. And I can see the positive.
Has been our foundation. It's created a stability in
everything
life,
that you've done.
Everything I've done.
Yeah.
I could have gone another way in life.
Mm. Yeah.
But I can honestly say, when hip hop found me, I would say it saved me because I don't think I was going to go and do anything bad anyway. But
sounds like AA, doesn't it?
It does. Yeah. I think it guided us into something that we kind of embraced and mastered, and it kind of, it looked after us.
Mm. Yeah, it just gave meaning.
It completely.
What we were doing, our life and everything.
You know, and everybody around us, which was fantastic, with particularly with the guys in the industry or on the scene, they protected us with kid gloves. Mm. You know what I mean? There was the utmost respect when we were anywhere.
We never ever, I can honestly say, never had any disrespect in any way from male artists or any. I mean, there is one.
Oh, come on. You've got to say one
though.
No. I'm not even going to say his name. He is American, so I could say it.
Yeah.
But
we do get American watches.
He was way back.
This is early days.
Early days. Oh,
really?
Well, thanks ever so much for coming in. That really has been a whirlwind, epic.
Fantastic.
Tour de force through UK hip hop history and US, and totally excellent. So thank you so much for making your way.
Do you like the shed?
Into the shed.
Oh, we love the shed.
You recommend the shed,
guys, girls. Listen, artists, young, old, whatever. You got to get into the shed, man. It's all about the shed.
Yeah.
Forget about your tools.
Yeah. That's right. Yeah, that was a phenomenal. Epic interview. Hopefully we've actually squeezed it all in. If not, you might have to see part two next week. But no, I think we're going to get it all in. We're going to squeeze it all in, yeah. Anyway, this is one that was discussed a little bit in the interview, and this is one that's quite prevalent to you guys, right?
We've got renamed the punk beats.
The punk beat?
Yeah, we used to call it, I don't know why, but we always knew it as punk beat, but we called business the other day and he was like, no, it's not called that. But that's what we called it in the old days. But
a bit like his video man for the Commodore's exactly. Assembly line. Yeah, but I think, you know.
What we're learning about UK hip hop acts is in the early days they couldn't read.
Basically, this was the B-boy anthem, so anytime this came on.
Yeah. We always wanted to see, this is just our early days of going to jams and the Breakers and Live to Break, All Stars, all the crews. When they were breaking to this track, we just loved it.
And Rock City did a bit of a dynamite one. We won't go into it, obviously, because you're friends.
History.
Yeah,
but Rock City crew, they did a routine to this back in the day at the Rock City, and they literally, this routine, their breaking routine to this was amazing. And any Rock City out there, I'm sure you remember it.
Mm-hmm. Hexy, where are you?
It was excellent. I love this track. Love
Wicked
this
tune, track. Yeah. So this is UFO by ESG from a South Bronx story, wasn't it? I think. So yeah, from the South Bronx, which is where you guys lived for a year or so.
Yeah, when you were immersed in it all. Completely immersed.
I've been past it, but there you go. Anyway, yeah, so from this, we're going to sort of like go to another one of their classic tunes that they loved back in the day. So here we go.
Hey, yo, check it out, man. Oh. What are you doing?
I'm just playing what you told me.
I like you to follow instructions, that's what I like.
Yeah, yeah. Kings of Pressure, you know how to reach us. Yeah.
Love this track. Love it. When this track came out, every time the DJs used to get so annoyed with us, every hip-hop day we were like, have you got Kings of Pressure, can you play it? You know, because it wasn't something that got people, we were just like, you've got to play that, because it's just an amazing track.
It's a wicked tune, wicked tune.
It's like we're in the smallest club in the world.
I know. I'm just happy that I've had all the records that they've asked for.
This is VIP guest list right here.
Yeah, this is it's the original 12 on Let's Go Records. So yeah, Kings of Pressure. Welcome into the shed anytime if you're still alive. Yeah, wicked tune, wicked tune. Yeah, so we're going to go to another one now. What have we got next? Ooh, we're going to a bit of De La next. So this is another one of the Cookies' favourites. You know how to reach us.
Susie thinks this is the best De La track.
It is.
You couldn't argue against it.
No, you can't.
The best ever. I love this song. My favourite track, my favourite De La track. And I can play this non-stop when I'm at home. I know all the lyrics. I stand in front of the mirror, do the whole thing. I love it. It's fantastic.
And we had the honour of touring with these guys, so that was fun too.
That's right. Again, De La, if you want to come into this show, no.
We know, you're always over here.
Yeah, that's it.
We'll come and get you.
Yeah. This is a killer tune. And it's so brilliant because they really did change themselves, didn't they, after that initial sort of like way they came out to this fantastic.
They just came with a different flavour and everything latched onto it, and it was hip hop friendly, man.
Yeah.
When I hear his lyrics on this track, I just find it I just love lyrically what he's saying, how he says it, everything about it, I love. And I just play it non-stop. I love this track.
And so we had this on a cassette tape.
Yeah.
There you go. Remember those kids? Yeah.
Making a comeback.
Yeah. Really? They are, yeah. People are sending them out as flyers and stuff.
Oh,
yeah.
Of course they are. Yeah. I think they've been creative.
Yeah, that's right. They're not.
They're the new cookie crew.
Soon, watch this space, yeah?
Yeah.
An arena tour.
Yeah.
Of course.
TDK D90s and an arena tour. There you go. You heard it here first. Anyway, so from the De La, we go to Main Source for our last track. Yeah, there could have been many Main Source tracks that we could have played, but obviously this isn't mine to play. It's for these guys, and it is probably one of their best, in my opinion, as well.
One of the best tracks.
We've got so much memories with this song, living in New York, and seeing the video, having the track on a cassette again. On a cassette, and we'd play this over and over again. Yeah. We had one tape in the apartment. We'd take the boombox into the bathroom. The next person will take the boombox into the bathroom. We even made our own video to this song.
We want to see that.
Yeah.
The person that had the original tape, you can't find it. So Terry, aka Desire, you need to find that.
Yeah, because I think a few people are going to want to see Main Source in the bathroom with the cookie tree.
We were obsessed
with
this song. Yeah, love it.
Yeah, and he's still rocking it now as well, Glass Professor as well.
But again, if you want to come in the shed.
Yeah. Actually,
he's got the key to the city, right?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, he's got the key to the shed if he wants it. There you go. Yeah, well, that's actually it from us. So we've actually liked our epic tour de force with the Cookie Crew. It's been an absolute pleasure. It's been
unbelievable,
brilliant. So many wicked stories in there as well. And ladies, it's been an absolute honour having you in here, and thanks for coming along. It's been so real.
We had a fantastic time. Thank you for inviting us.
And I got terrorised by Luca as well. So there you go. Yeah. Anyway,
thank you very much, and we'll catch you next week when it's just me and Chris.
Yeah. Anyway. See you later.
Because I'm the one that's claimed to love for life. Brilliant. But all I can do is pray here in strife.